The Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 21st chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, Jesus said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be? And what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray. For many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and 'the time is near.' Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified. For these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name. But not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. So the Bible reading today reminds me quite a bit about a TV show I used to watch growing up. And I'm sure a few people here watched it as well, called I Love Lucy. Now, yes, I admit I watched the reruns, but what a great show. And the reason that I Love Lucy comes to mind is because this gospel reading, we hear it today in this version, and we also hear it in one of the other gospels, and it really gets to this idea of birth pangs. Jesus actually is quoted as using that phrase in one of the other gospels when talking about this story of wars and rumors of wars and all these things that are going to happen. And he says in that, this is just the beginning of the birth pangs. And so in this one I Love Lucy episode, it's the one where little Ricky is about to be born. And so Lucy's in the delivery room, and Fred, one of their neighbors, is out in the waiting room where Ricky is as well. This is back before we were allowed to go in with our spouses during that time. But there's this other man out there whose wife is giving birth. And the man he tells them, "Well, I've already got six daughters. I'm just hoping for one son, just hoping for one." And so then the doctor comes out of the delivery room, and the man is excited and says, "I know, I love my daughters, but I'm guessing it's another girl, right?" And the doctor said, "Well, no, sir, no, it's not." And he leaped up and he said, "Oh, great, love my daughters, but I'm having a boy. I'm finally going to get to have a boy." And he said, "Well, not exactly. Well, what do you mean?" And he said, "Three girls, triplets." To which, of course, Fred, their neighbor, said, "Well, look on the bright side. With nine girls, you now have a baseball team." So these stories, though in more lighthearted ways, remind us that things like birth are usually not easy times. Sometimes we think that all of the craziness of having a child begins after childbirth, and I certainly remember that shocking exhaustion of those first few days after, well, and weeks and months after our daughters were born. But it does seem that there's a lot of craziness and confusion right before the birth as well. But once the baby is born, or multiple babies, I guess, in that one case, the beauty of the child is so extraordinary that it overwhelms us. And as new parents, we love our children, but it, of course, doesn't mean it's going to be easy. However, the result, the children, are so extraordinary that the difficulties and the struggles are worth every minute after that. This seems to be what Jesus is hinting at when he talks in such apocalyptic language about wars and rumors of wars before the end of time. He is, of course, predicting the destruction of the Jewish temple in Jerusalem in this reading. And he said, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." And just a few years after Jesus said it, after he was crucified, the people of Judea led a revolt against the Romans, and sure enough, the Romans destroyed the entire holy temple of the Jewish people, and it has never been rebuilt to this day. They so destroyed it and burned it down that the gold in the temple was said to be flowing out into the streets in molten form. Now, this must have sounded terrifying to Jesus' followers when he first said that it would happen. I mean, imagine if somebody told us that the U.S. Capitol or the White House was going to be destroyed. It would not be very encouraging. Well, the temple for the Jewish people was the central location and building of their faith as well as their government, just as the Capitol is the center of our democracy, except that there was, you know, for them, they had a part of a religious connotation to it as well. But even in the midst of this terrifying idea, Jesus tells them, "When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be afraid." Well, it would frighten us, wouldn't it? But of course, Jesus says, this must take place. The end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation. He goes on and on about all of these things. But the idea is, this is just the beginning before we're delivered into something more. And like it's quoted in that other version in the other gospel where it says this is the beginning of the birth pangs, there truly is a connection between birth pangs and delivery. In most circumstances, women experience birth pangs before the child is, what do we call it, delivered. And we experience birth pangs before we are delivered into the kingdom of God. The moment just before birth, just before delivery, can be the most difficult in the delivery of the child. But in normal circumstances, where the baby and the mother are healthy, the result is so overwhelming that sometimes the thought of the pain goes into the past. Whenever we seem to face anything worth accomplishing, anything worth the struggle, isn't it also often hardest and most challenging right before the result is achieved? You know, although common sense tells us that, what's that phrase we often use, that there's a calm before the storm, Christian sense tells us that there's often a storm before the calm. Before the world is transformed and delivered into what God wants it to be, there are tremendous birth pangs. Now, some of the youth that we work with through Samaritas, which you know is formerly known as Lutheran Social Services in Michigan, they experienced terrible pains before we've been able to help deliver them into a brighter and better future. Some of these youth I think about are the youth who are in our foster system that we send to camp each year. We try to send 60 youth to Stony Lake Lutheran Camp, where maybe some of you, your family, your friends have gone. And we send them there because we want them to experience a grace-filled week where they come to know that they have a God who loves them, no strings attached. Where they come to know that there are people like us out there who love them, no strings attached, as an expression of the love of our same God. Some of these youth, the things they went through are beyond belief. I mean, I'll talk, one girl in particular, I'm gonna change her name. We're gonna call her Rebecca today. And she went through things that might have overwhelmed most of us. It would have taken me out completely. And so Rebecca went to camp, and she had a very difficult first night at camp, a sort of birth pangs, if you will, before the rest of her week. The reason she had such trouble is because Rebecca did not have her comfort noise when she went to sleep. Now, does everybody hear, do you know what I mean when I say a comfort noise to help you fall asleep? Does anybody have something like a fan, maybe? Shout it out. What are your comfort noises? Fan? Fan? Okay, I have the bad habit of a television set, which means that my wife has the bad habit of marrying somebody who needs a television set. although she's breaking me of that. That's a right word to use. We have comfort noises. What did Rebecca learn to fall asleep to? The sound of violence, the sound of fighting, the sound of people hurting one another. What does it do to a child when they need to hear that to be at peace, to fall asleep? So Rebecca had a tough first night. And on top of that, she was staying in a cabin that had no locks on the outside. Because when she was younger, she lived in a place that had locks not just to protect you from the people outside of the home, but inside of the home too. So it wasn't easy for her. Here she is, hearing the sound of the breeze from Lake Michigan blowing up above, rustling the leaves over her head. Something many of us plan an entire year to make happen, spend a fortune just to experience. But not for her. But you see, here's the good news. By the end of the week, she knew that there's a better way to live. She experienced peace and knew that we have a God who has a bright and good future planned for each and every one of us. She knew that there were people like here at Faith Lutheran in Okemos and other congregations around the state, and now a growing number of non-Lutheran congregations that are joining on as well, who would send her to camp as this gift simply because we love her and want her to know that there is a bright future for her. Another neat little thing about this camp experience is that a lot of youth, when they're put into foster homes, are separated from one another because you just can't keep 4, 6, 8 kids in one home. And this week, they get to just be brothers and sisters again. Sisters and brothers playing games, swimming, learning how to sail. That's the gift that we give them after the tumultuous life that they've had so far. That's the kind of thing that we do because we are a people who believe not that there's a calm before the storm, but that there's a storm before the calm. And this lesson translates into all areas of our lives as well. I mean, God repeatedly delivers us into something new and greater, which brings us to the great lesson that Jesus teaches us today, which is that no matter where we experience them in life, we are not to fear these tumultuous moments. Even if they have a sense of evil attached to them, we have a greater strength from Jesus to help us through this time, no matter how dark the night is. I mean, isn't that after all what we pray in the Lord's Prayer? We pray, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver. There's that word again. Deliver us from evil. It doesn't mean help us escape evil or flee from anything challenging. It does mean, dear God, deliver us through this time of trouble and trial. Bring about your greater plan sooner rather than later. It does mean, please give us strength during this time of trial so that we can be a great witness rather than be tempted to just give in to evil and simply let it prevail. And that is one of the beauties of the Christian life. We don't have to give in. We have a greater strength in the Spirit of Christ who dwells in us. We have a hope, even if not the knowledge, we have the hope that the birth pangs are a sign of something greater to come, of a new life into which we're delivered. So, of course, it would still be weird then to turn to our neighbors, thinking about all of that frustration and pain that we can have in life and say, ah, don't worry about it, something better is going to come. I mean, that would be ridiculous as the man who says to the woman giving birth, it's not that bad, right? I mean, something good's going to happen. I'm wise enough, hopefully, not to have said that today because it's just insensitive and ridiculous. But the reality is that something good, something great, might just be on the horizon. You know, I'm just thinking this week how important that is for us too, you know, as people here, as we gather as people of faith. I don't think any of us would think that it's been a less than bumpy week, right? And of course, you know, there's things that have happened this week that have, say, divided the people of Michigan 50-50 right down the line. And of course, you know, I'm talking about Michigan tragically losing to Iowa last night. Okay, I'm a little too close to East Lansing to say that, right? But that's my point. There are so many things that do divide us. There are. When we share the peace today, We are those people who boldly say that there can be a storm before the calm. Because the sharing of the peace, it's not a chance for us to say, how you doing, or to catch up or make sure we have our meeting planned. It's an opportunity to say that no matter what the world puts in front of us, no matter our differences of opinion, no matter our backgrounds, our beliefs, how we live our lives, no matter what the world tries to use to split us apart, Jesus Christ is stronger. No matter what people say must pull us apart so that we are uncivil and unfriendly and unneighborly, Jesus Christ calls us to be one. When we celebrate Holy Communion, it's not about a chance of just saying like, hey, we're doing this because we all agree with each other. Isn't that great? No, we're doing that because despite our disagreements, we come together on one thing. The Spirit of Christ is in all of us and leads us all to work with each other. And that's why as we move forward, as all of us, as a people, especially as a Christian people here, it's important to strive and focus on what Christ calls us to do and who Christ calls us to be. A people united in mission to share God's love in Jesus Christ. You know, that's the mission of Samaritas, serving people as an expression of the love of Christ. We have great unity as Christians in serving people in this way. That's how we've become the largest private foster and adoption agency in the state of Michigan. We become the largest refugee resettlement organization in the state, fourth largest in the nation, helping people like Christians from Iraq, people from the Congo, find peace, to live without fear. It's how we have senior communities across the state and are now growing with in-home health care and services for the homeless and for people with disabilities. We do all of this because that's what we're about. That's what pulls us together. It's like that song, they all know that we are Christians by our love. You know, so as we go ahead in the next few weeks and months and years, as we continue to have different opinions, not just as Americans, but as Christians, we want to remember that one thing really brings us together and one thing pulls us through the storm, and that's Jesus calling us to a bright and better future. You know, quite frankly, our nation has seen some pretty bumpy times before. The election of 1800, John Adams accused Thomas Jefferson of being the Antichrist. That was a fun time. And Andrew Jackson in 1928, when his wife was accused of things, shot and killed the person who'd said it. This is documented in a duel. That's before the people voted for him. When Abraham Lincoln was elected in 1860, before he was even sworn in, our nation was dividing apart, and 600,000 people died as a result. Now, that's part of our past, but that doesn't have to be part of our future. Because as Christians, we have a better witness. We have a witness that despite the bumpiness, despite the birth pangs, despite the struggle, we gather together in a united witness of sharing the love of God in Jesus Christ. And that leads us into God's preferred future. Amen.